since about a year ago, January, on COVID funding, so I wanted to get everyone up to speed. Although you're familiar with the budgeting through the budget amendments and presentations of Randy. So I'm gonna start to talk about what we received with the COVID relief funding and how we budgeted for it, what's been spent and what we're still expending. So there were three acts that responded to the COVID pandemic. The first, which almost everybody's familiar with, is the CARES Act. And it involves several funding sources, ESSER I, GEAR, and CRF funds. And I'll go a little bit more in depth as we go through the presentation. But we have almost expended all of those funds. And the purpose of those funds was to respond to health, safety, and virtual learning needs brought about by the pandemic, those immediate needs. And then the second funding source is the Coronavirus Response and Relief Supplemental Appropriations Act, and it gave us ESSER II and ESSER II Reserve. And the purpose of that was to prepare for both virtual and in-person learning, social emotional learning, and learning loss as a result of interrupted in-person learning due, of course, to the pandemic. And then the third and final act was the American Rescue Plan Act of 2021, Elementary and Secondary Emergency Relief. It's, we call it ARP or ARP-ESSER, but really everybody calls it ESSER III because it was the third funding source. But that gave us several different grants, and one of that was ARP-ESSER, ARP-ESSER Reserve, ARP-1 Homeless, and ARP-2 homeless. These have to be expended by different times. ESSER-1 and that funding source with that act must be expended by this coming September. But like I said, most of those funds have already been expended. Then the ESSER-2 funding must be spent by September 2023 and ARP-ESSER by September of 2024. But if you would notice in that ARP-ESSER, the purpose is now to safely reopen and sustain in-person instruction and address the impact of all the learning loss brought about by the pandemic. So we've seen a gradual shift in focus to reacting to COVID and that immediate response to the pandemic to now recovery and really funding for the impact of the learning loss. On the next slide, I just gave a brief overview, and these are totals of all the grants involved in each funding source. So with the CARES Fund, we received a little over $2 million. With the ESSER-2 funding, we received almost $5 million. And then with ARP-ESSER funding, we received about $11.5 million. So I'm just really gonna go quickly through ESSER-1 because I've already presented that to the board. I just wanna remind everyone of where we started. But I also would like to say that our budgets are on the website. The only one that's down right this second is ESSER-2 because we're tweaking it and getting a final approval from the State Department, but it'll be back on the website. So if I go too fast and you wanna revisit, you can always go to our website to see our budget. So, like I said, the CARES Act had several different funding sources. One was ESSER-1, and that's the $1,180,766. Really, the only balance we have left is what the public school had not spent. We did have to offer our public school part of our allocation, and they did accept. So they've got about 13,000 more to spend, and they have to spend it by September, or that goes back to the federal government. It does not come to us. So I'm encouraging them. I've got a meeting soon to talk to them about that balance. The second funding source was the GEAR budget, and it was for $217,368, and it could only be spent in three categories: for bus Wi-Fi, for learning and achievement gaps, and for before and after school tutoring. We did end up Moving our allocation for bus Wi-Fi to before and after school tutoring. And that was primarily to fund Georgiana and Mackenzie's after school and summer programs, because we have 21st Century Grant for W.O. Palmer, Greenville Elementary School. We have School Improvement Grant with Greenville Middle School, and 21st Century with Greenville High School. So the greatest need was with Georgiana and Mackenzie. So that's why we tended to spend that money there. And then the last of the CARES Act funding is the CRF grants, and that's actually two grants in one. The first grant was Education, Health, and Wellness, and the second was Educational Remote Learning Devices. And really with the Health and Wellness, what we did is just pour a bunch of money into trying to make everybody safe during the pandemic. That's where we bought all of our PPE, our sanitation supplies, that's nursing supplies, setting up those nursing rooms. That also was where we purchased a lot of the thermometers that we used initially. So that got us started with the ability to mitigate the spread of the virus. And then of course the remote learning, that really started our one-to-one initiative. And those funds actually had to be spent by December 2020. So that got us up and running with our one-to-one initiative. But again, those funds have been expended. So we're moving into ESSER II, or the CURSA Act, because it makes you CURSA sometimes. And the total budget for that is $4,893,913. Sorry, I get tongue twisted. Okay, you got me?
Okay.
ESSER II, we had almost $5 million. The only additional allowable expense past ESSER I is they did allow us to do some facility improvements as it relates to mitigating the spread of infectious disease. And then ESSER II reserve, all of those funds had to be spent in course of study ELA PD, course of study math PD, and assessment for grades 4 through 8. And that's because with some state funding, they had already funded assessment for K-3. And those are like your universal screeners. It's additional because we changed and we have a new state assessment, whatever needs those bring about. But the teachers in the room know we have gotten a new math course of study last year. This was to help prepare. And this year we're getting a new ELA course of study. So that was monies that they earmarked so that we had monies to train teachers with those two course of studies. I'm not gonna talk about ESSER II. Again, I'm gonna go ahead and move on to the larger part of money, ESSER II. I'm not gonna talk about the reserve, I'm gonna go on to ESSER II. So these funds could only be spent in four categories. And within those categories, there were subcategories. So we weren't able to just spend these funds however we thought we needed it or however we wanted. So we had the four categories were high quality instructional materials, professional development, unfinished learning supports, and facilities improvement. And I'm gonna go into each one of these. So, with the high quality instructional materials, our ELA materials were spent on Lexicore, which is our reading intervention program, Accelerated Reader, Mion, and other literacy materials such as Scholastic books. And as you may know, the Mion is our virtual library, so it houses tons of virtual books, and we were trying to prepare for both in classroom and virtual learning at this point. So we're if we had to toggle back and forth. The math, and these are for 2 years, so it really funded part of last school year and this school year, and then ESSER III picks up where ESSER II leaves off with some of these programs. And then the math materials, we purchased all of our math textbooks. And I know if folks have not bought textbooks for every child in a system, they may not realize how very expensive those are along with the ancillary materials. We spent almost $500,000 on our math textbooks and to get a book in every child, get all the materials, the support materials, and the same thing we did with ESSER III with ELA textbooks. And then we also have our online intervention programs, Dreambox and Freckles for High School. We may expand that next year. And we bought graphing calculators as well. For our high quality professional development, we have so many other funding sources for professional development that we didn't feel we needed to budget in that category for ESSER II. We fund professional development through Title I, Title II, Title IV, ESSER II Reserve, as you saw, ESSER III Reserve, and then we get state PD monies as well. So we didn't feel like we needed to create a line item in that category. The next category is unfinished learning supports. And there were five subcategories within the unfinished learning supports. One was assessment and screeners, and that's where we paid for our universal screener is STAR Reading. And PowerSchool Performance Matters and Analytics, that helps us disaggregate, collect all of our data from all of these different assessments and programs. And it helps us evaluate how those programs are going and analyze and disaggregate our data. So that's that program. Then there's transitions, one of our subcategories. And we put it in two of those transitions primarily. One, that transition from high school to college, and then preparing kids to do that with our ACT prep program, CERT, and our school to work, CTE. We have several programs we're funding, Build It Better, Soft Skills USA, and Career Save. And then one of the other subcategories, and you'll see this over and over again, remediation and interventions. There's tons of money earmarked and protected just for interventions because of the learning loss brought to us, well, the learning loss experienced by our students through the pandemic. So that is primarily earmarked for summer interventions, and that's for transportation during the summer to pay for our nurses, librarians, and counselors. You'll see where we funded teachers in other places. And then we did not put any funds in for family support resources because we picked that up in ESSER III and Title IV. So we do have plans for some family engagement resources, but those are in other funding sources. Still in unfinished learning supports, there's some other tools, and there's some online PD programs like LinkSpring that our teachers can access and our principals can use to help give our teachers individualized professional development. We also are building teacher capacity through a program called Creating Communities of Excellence. Another professional development program we use is Powerful Conversations Network. And it's also to sustain our one-to-one initiative. It helped pick up where we needed to replace, buy new, all of those Chromebooks and technology products from back in December with that initial funding. There's a lot of money that goes into sustaining something like that. And then I'm really excited that this year we hope to finally start a STEM initiative. We had so many new things going that we didn't want to throw everything at the schools in one fell swoop. So we're hoping to really set up STEM labs and get someone that can manage that process of professional development, making sure all of our kids have an opportunity to participate in STEM activities. So a good portion of that money is set aside for STEM initiative. And then the last category, I guess in my rush, I didn't include a slide on it, that, and it's facilities. And we spent $1,064,592 in the facilities line items. We have already expended the majority of that money, and the big pot came from the HVAC. We're getting new HVAC systems at the middle school and repairing some of our older, and in order to create a better air quality and to mitigate disease. So we got us started with the first million in ESSER II, and then we pick it up in ESSER III to complete that project, and I'll talk about that when we get there. We also purchased some floor scrubbing machines, and of course, PPE and sanitation supplies. All right, we are to ARP ESSER, the final funding source, and it is the funding source where we receive the majority of funds. We have dipped very little into this pot, but as you can tell when I'm talking about ESSER II, I'm getting that set up to sustain all of our programs from ESSER II. We're taken to ESSER III. There are four funding sources provided by the ARP ESSER Act. There's ARP ESSER, which everybody calls ESSER III. There's ESSER Reserve III. And there's ARP ESSER Homeless I and ARP ESSER Homeless II. So the first is ARP ESSER or ESSER III. And the initial allocation was the $10,719,000. We only spent in fiscal year 21, $25,000, and that was to pay for our alternative school facilitator. And I'll show you where that personnel is in the line item budget. So we had the remaining $10,694,000 to budget for this year. 20% of those funds had to be spent on interventions within the following categories. Intervention A was summer learning and enrichment programs, and that's for two summers. That covers some summer salaries for some of our personnel and summer supplies. Intervention B is extended day programs, and again, that picks up where our other grants leave off. And that's for after-school salaries and benefits and after-school supplies. Also included in the 20%, we didn't budget money because there was already an intervention for after-school. We didn't budget any money in Intervention D, which is extended school year program. And then, nor did we budget money in Intervention C because we, that should be, that actually should be extended school year program. Oh, it is. Intervention D is extended school year program. We don't have that. And the after school program is Intervention C, I'm sorry. Intervention E is where we have a lot of our social emotional learning interventions budgeted and a lot of our academic interventions budgeted. So we have money set aside for mental health services, our alternative school facilitator. We have this year, I believe has been the first year for our Be the Vessel mentoring program, and that's a young man who has started a program mentoring our young males in crisis, our adolescent males in crisis. We've initiated the Peer Helpers program, which Ms. Zania Powell facilitates and runs. We also have some special populations interventions. Our online intervention programs are paid through this funding source, and so are our SPED sensory room supplies. Our academic interventions, this ESSER III picks up Freckle and STAR. We also fund six academic interventionists who are retired teachers. And it pays for our intervention supplies and materials. The remaining 80% is spent, we had nine categories past those interventions that we spent the monies in. One of the largest is personnel, and we pay for our lead nurse, our COVID safety and supervisor, Mr. Dane, two high school instructional coaches, a portion of each ARI reading coach, a tech support person we have hoped to hire, help Matthew and Ashley out with all these new devices. It has been quite busy for them. A STEM specialist, six long-term subs, one for each school, and then we have a line item for other compensation for additional work. So if teachers stay after for a parent night, or if they do additional work outside contract hours, or anyone that works in our system who does additional work, we can access that line item. We have a little over 400,000 set aside to sustain our one-to-one. And one thing I'm excited about, and I'm sure our counselors are too, is Matthew is heading up getting us an online enrollment program. So hopefully that will help be more parent friendly. Also, one of our categories was facility improvements, and that of course is only to mitigate disease, and that's to pick up where that ESSER 2 left off with the HVAC. We did put some professional development monies aside here for purchase services, travel training, stipends, and subs. There are additional curriculum materials in a category, and that's our ESSER 2 paid for our math textbooks. ESSER 3 is going to pay for our new ELA textbooks and all those materials and supplies, and then to sustain the programs that we've purchased through ESSER 2 through September of 2024. And while I'm looking at those programs, I thought, oh great, we can buy like 10 years worth of a subscription for Star Reading. But all subscriptions, online subscriptions, have to end when the funding source ends. So it's not like we can purchase past September 2024. We did put some parent engagement funds because there was a category set aside for that in ARP ESSER. And we hope to start a parent university. Ms. Zania Powell is heading that. And we have some money set aside for family engagement supplies. Again, because COVID has not gone away, we have money for PPE and sanitation supplies and equipment. With all the new purchases, we needed help with our inventory. So we have hired an inventory service, Hayes, to come in and help us manage all of the equipment and technology that we've purchased. And then last but not least, we have money set aside for our bus communication system. obviously, it's not smart or good for bus drivers to be riding with a cell phone. I mean, and sometimes even when they have the bus pulled over and they're trying to get in touch with a parent on these rural back roads, there's no way to communicate with anybody. So we're trying to bring them into the 20th century and get them a reliable communication source. Our ESSER, that ESSER 3 reserve. This funding source is to address K through 3 literacy and can only be used in the following categories. And we did not get to decide how much money goes into these categories. So $400,000 again goes into learning loss interventions. The state prefers an extended day focus or summer focus interventions outside the school day. So right now we have those in salaries and benefits for teachers, librarians, and counselors during the summer. But we may tweak that a little bit because there's already a lot of money that's been earmarked for summer and after school. So we'll just have to see how our program goes this year and then budget accordingly. And then after school programs for the next 2 years as well. Our ESSER Homeless One it was only an allocation of almost $16,000, but with this money, we can pay for health service referrals so that if our child is experiencing homelessness, they need to see a doctor. We can purchase some of those services past what Medicaid pays, or if they are without insurance, we can help out there. Help supplies such as eyeglasses. And for the first time, we're able to help out with housing costs. If a family like this year, we had a family who 18-wheeler hit their home and they were essentially forced out of their home. So we were able to put them in a place for 2 weeks until they could find some stable housing. And then indirect costs. That indirect cost is with most of our federal funds, the system can hold a portion of those funds. It's done through a formula and for managing the grant. And actually, they don't have as much restrictions as we do on those funds. And last but not least, ARP Homeless 2. And this is how, when our children are identified as homeless, we can purchase uniforms, coats, shoes, toiletries, just items that they're gonna need. And we can pay for transportation costs. Kids who are deemed homeless are able to go to their school of origin, wherever that might be, and we may have to pay for transportation in that, so we always set aside some money for that. And then again, indirect costs. And last but not least, I just have my slide. I'm not gonna read them all, but it takes a village and everybody's pitching in and doing right for children with the blessings that we've gotten with this funding. It's a lot. It's a lot of new programs on teachers. It's a lot of new things to manage. But with that, I believe we've been given an amazing opportunity to start some programs we would have never been able to without this funding. Are there any questions?
Great job, Sadir. Thank you. That's a lot of money to handle. And shall go around in revision after revision after revision, which you've done a beautiful job handling all of those, and we appreciate it. We know that everything decision you make is from the standpoint of what benefits the child, and we appreciate that.
Absolutely. Item number 4 is approval of minutes and payroll.
Yes. I recommend the board approval of minutes and payroll for the April 19, 2022 regular meeting and the May 12, 2022 special call meeting.
You've heard the superintendent's recommendation to have a motion.
Motion. Second.
Any questions? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, nay. Item number 5 is the report of fundraising drives and requests for use of school buses. This is an informational item, so there's no action needed on that particular item. Item number 6 is the financial report.
Yes, I'd like to ask the board or recommend the board for their approval of the financial statement of March 2022. Approval of reconciled bank statement March 2022. Approval of budget amendment.
You've heard the superintendent's recommendation. Do I have a motion?
Motion. Second.
Okay. Any questions? We have Ms. Mosley.
Ms. Mosley has a.
Okay, that's what I'd like to say. We're going to get something on budget amendments at the sidewalk up here.
Yes.
I figured you're about to say something.
Yes. Yeah. So I just want to go through a quick little report. This is the financial report for the second quarter of fiscal year 2022. for March 2022, accounts payable expenditures were $572,635. The gross payroll for March was $2,284.77. The ending general fund balance at the end of March was $6,372,404, which is 3.14 months of operations. And the net operations year to date was $11,704,404.84. The next slide, the fiscal year 22 schedule of debt. We made some payments in the first quarter. We didn't have any debt payments in the second quarter, which was the end of March. But in April, we did make our annual payment on the 22 school buses, and we have one more payment left on that. We may have 2023, but then we'll have to replace those 22 school buses. And then this week, we made almost $1.9 million in debt payments on the 2015, 2021, and 2021A and B series. So all the debt payments for the year have been made. The next slide shows our the ending fund balance for the general fund, and you can just see over the years, and I put this in here every quarter, but back in 2017, we're at 2.6, and we dropped down, and we've been climbing since then. So again, at the end of March, and I just said this, we had 6.3 million, which is 3.14 months of reserve. The third quarter will show your April, May, and June. In April, it will be down some. It dropped about $300,000. So we're at about 3 months of reserve right now. And that'll decline a little bit. We'll probably end the year with around 2.5 months of reserve. The next slide is the 1 cent sales tax analysis. Mid-year sales tax collections are up just slightly, 0.76% compared to the same time period last year. The sales tax, if you'll look at the individual months, you can see that in January, February, March, the collections were lower than the same months in last year. And so if that trend continues, the growth will decline. But hopefully it will pick up, but I'm not so sure about that with gas prices. And then the next chart just shows the same information, but it's in graph form. You can see how it's dropped off. The next slide is the property tax analysis, and mid-year property tax collections are up 7.4% compared to the same time period last year. And that's just due to assessments going up and probably more property, like Hyundai or washing. And the last slide is on the budget amendment. I don't have my paper here in front of me. We had to do a budget amendment at least one a year. This year is only one because we waited so late about doing it. It just took it so long because we had so much more money come in. We used to have around a $33 million budget, and now we have around a $60 million budget. So it's almost doubled in size, and that's mainly due to all the ESSER funding that we've received. But the general fund balance is what I'm going to talk about. We're showing in a general fund ending balance of $4,575,900 at the end of this fiscal year, which is 2.26 months of reserve. I feel like that will change a little bit because the ATF money is budget amendment, so that'll put us around 2.5 or 2.6 or so, depending on how much we spend in this fiscal year as well. But that's a surplus of $217,321, which is a growth in the general fund. The special revenue fund is showing a deficit of $96,749.67. And the special revenue fund is where all your federal funds are accounted for. And that's because the budgeted CMP expenditures exceeded the revenues, which is okay because the CMP fund balance was 5.5 months at the end of September 2021, and the state requests that we have no more than 3 months of reserve. I'm not really sure why, but they want us to stay at the 3 month mark. So we need to spend some money there, and Miss Linda, I know, has bought some furniture for some of the cafeteria, so that should help get that fund balance down some. And then the capital projects fund shows a deficit of $3.5 million, but that's only because the money that we had borrowed from Stiefel, or through Stiefel, the bonds issue, that revenue was recognized last year, and then the expenditures were budgeted this year. So we're still good in that fund. Any questions?
You have something? You must speak next one. Okay, then I'll construction on Pleasant Creek Middle School.
And we are so excited that that is happening for you. Ms. Bowers, are you here? No. LaVita?
Oh, yeah.
Tell us what you're doing, congratulations.
I am moving back to Greenville Middle School.
Yay. Yes, she will be at Greenville Middle School for a change, and she's
stuff that this old, it would be easy to get rid of. It's not. We have to go through a legal process of identifying these items and putting them out and slash selling them if there's no value to them, donating them, and you can only donate them to certain places and certain groups. You can send them overseas, but there's just huge process that you have to go through to do this. And so this is what we're approving, is that enormous process to get through all of these textbooks. So you've heard the superintendent's recommendation to have a motion.
Motion.
A second.
Second.
Okay, any questions about disposal of this property? Okay, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, nay. Item number 11, legal update. We